My name is Devesh Govinda. I'm a solution specialist. I look after our data and AI space at Microsoft. And this is basically the most exciting time in my career that I can remember. You're getting a lot of buzzwords, right? A lot of terms that people are throwing at you. How do we make this real? Number one. Number two, what are the key components that will bring this fourth industrial revolution over the next decade? And then I'll show you a few real-world examples as well. You happy? Okay, I think she's happy. Okay, so let's look at where we've come. Now, in the industry, if you follow the industry, a lot of movement in 18 months. What we've seen over the last, let's say, 24 months, human parity in object recognition, right? We got that in 2016. This is just internal. There's more in the rest of the industry as well, by the way. Speech recognition, human parity, reading comprehension, and then translation. So one, you know, another company out there, I'll mention the name, Google, they had a bot that had, basically, it could pass the Turing test. And we also did one at Microsoft. We did it in Chinese. That's important for what is to follow. The front end, the edge, needs to be able to talk to you, interact with humans. That's one piece. The other pieces are data, big data, lots of data, offsetting processing power into the cloud, and of course, intelligence at that edge. That is the life cycle that will deliver these solutions. So let's have a look. Okay, two slides with a few trends. What we're seeing is that most applications will embed some form of AI. Okay, so there's a stat that I pulled. This year, 50% of applications will have some form of AI. You're already seeing machine learning and you know, neural processing on you at the edge. How many of you have a device called an iPhone X? Okay, there's another brand, Huawei, they're also doing this. So when you unlock your iPhone, you need to look at it and it recognizes your face. In that A10 chip, they've built in some form of hardware-based neural engine for face recognition. More of that will come to the devices, you know, your phone. This isn't actually a phone, by the way. This is a pocket computer, and I'll tell you why. And then the devices on you, your smartwatch, which I'm wearing something, you can call it a health device, and even your clothing. I'll talk about that very quickly. And then the software running across the spectrum, edge to the cloud, will have AI at every point, very important, okay, in order to get things done. And then what I'm seeing personally, I work with a lot of big customers. I work, you know, me personally, with a lot of the banks. A lot of customers are now, enterprises, are putting AI projects, you know, some of them in the lab and some of them out of the lab and into production. We're seeing that big. So this concept of the edge, we had, let's say 10 years ago, I was involved in building data warehouses, right? And there were a few things that would scare me where I want to almost run from a project. The first is very large amounts of data, okay? We saw that growing and growing and growing. The second is when somebody said real time. If you wanted to get me to leave the building, you just had to say real time, okay? A very difficult thing to actually deliver. But that is what we need for the type of solutions you've seen in some of the other presentations, okay? And we found that big data made necessary the cloud, because you're going to have that scale for larger and larger volumes of data. I've got customers, you know, a few, let's say 200-300 terabytes, very common, by the way. I see it all the time. Petabytes, we've got systems in the petabytes. And then how do you scale the processing? How do you process, if you're running a machine learning model, across that amount of data? Do you do it on x86? Do you use GPU, FPGA? This is why the cloud's important, because the cloud de-risks that and allows you to, you know, if GPU platform is the best for neural networks going forward, you're going to run that in the cloud. You're not going to buy that hardware. But then we found, in order to deliver real-time and solutions that actually add value, we needed intelligence at the edge. And that's where that comes in, okay? So devices at the edge of the cloud will become smarter and smarter and smarter. They're going to take any shape or form. It's not just a phone or a watch or a sensor in a manufacturing environment, a plant environment. Literally, there's almost no end to how these devices will look and feel. All that's important is that IoT will happen with edge devices. You will see more and more of these, and basically, they're going to become more and more intelligent. So if you feared that in the era of cloud, hardware will become less sexy, you're going to see more hardware than ever, more innovation in hardware. I'm going to show you at the end. So this is a little shift that we see. And you will see AI at every single point, okay? I'll take away the industrial scenario and talk in a few slides' time on a more personal scenario. Okay, another pattern that we're seeing to complement this, so the one in the middle, AI at every point. Edge, location, cloud, different applications running throughout. And this is how we're going to deliver all these sexy solutions that you've seen in the other presentations. We're seeing a move to serverless, and we're seeing a move to multi-device. So this will exist across devices, the ability to do cognitive services, to do machine learning, pattern detection, object detection. Well, first object detection and then pattern detection. So what I've got, and I hope we can get it right, is a little demo on a company that we've helped literally transform, okay? This is showing you how big data, IoT, machine learning transforms an industry. Now, the airline industry is very, tight margin, ultra competitive, and the engine manufacturer, in this case, Rolls-Royce is an engine manufacturer. They provide the service to their customers where they're doing now real-time monitoring, full optimization, predictive maintenance, and on a particular flight route, let's say from Johannesburg to Dubai, if you're burning just a few percentage points more fuel, that costs thousands of dollars. Over a 12-month period, that can cost millions of dollars, okay? Especially if you look at the global network. That's the one thing, cost. Of course, safety is more important, okay? You want to have absolutely the best safety. So how do we do this? How do we make this real? So this is on the web. So now you're seeing this demo. I'm just going to go over to one side here. We can do predictive maintenance. This is actually in production with one of the big three German car manufacturers, and they're using AI in the cloud. Of course, the sensors and IoT is in-engine, so we wouldn't touch that, okay? But there's a good amount of interoperability with these solutions. So here, something on the propulsion. So the stats are fine. This is at the plane level. If we click now on that, it's giving us a view of the engine, and it's telling me, okay, it's a Rolls-Royce Trent engine, the fuel pump inside the engine. We're not happy with the amount of fuel. Now, I just want to pause there before you click. IoT and BI, which we've had for maybe 20 years, can give you this. The AI piece that assists the IoT scenario, IoT projects will be AI projects. The value of those projects enhances exponentially when you add machine learning and AI. And of course, both of those need big data. So they will be, by default, big data projects as well. That's why me, being on the big data side at Microsoft, we get involved in this. So just to finish this demo, I'm looking at time. Let's click on the fuel pump, and what we can do is it then takes me to a BI side, a BI report, more detail. All of those are from sensors, things like even the valve position and how much is the valve opening and closing. Let me share something with you. Your car, if it was made in the last 10 years, is collecting all of that data, okay? And it's logging it, and they, you take it to a dealer, they plug in something on the CAN bus. Even the average car today generates gigs, if not tens of gigs of data per hour, I would say, if you really turn on everything. Okay, IoT, big data, and with AI, predictive maintenance, okay? And then what we can do is request maintenance. There's a concept called digital twin. Who's heard of this? So in the airline industry, they use digital twins. You're going to hear about this a lot more. You have a plane in the air, and you have a digital simulation running in a machine learning model. That's the digital twin. And while that plane's flying, you can play around with a few factors here and say, well, what happens if this happens? If the burn rate of the fuel gets worse, do we have a problem? Real-time simulation, you give feedback to the pilots. And that digital twin concept is becoming more and more prevalent, right? And then from here, of course, let's notify the technicians and let's confirm we can book a service crew. When the plane lands at London Heathrow, the service crew is ready. This is how we change, one example, the airline industry. Okay, you can apply this to almost any industry. Okay, so hit confirm and it'll show you basically. We're just looking at time. So we need to move. I'm going to give you another scenario, right? Why I'm so passionate and excited about this space. A year ago, just over a year ago, I wrote an article called Personal AI, where I spoke of one of my vision that you're going to see machine learning on you, on your personal devices, your phones, your devices, and your smart clothing. Some of the examples are so mind-boggling. And what's really impressed me is that some of these things have come true, right, in the last 12 months. For example, I've got a smartwatch. It measures right now. It's measuring heartbeat. I go for a run. It'll measure my steps. You might think I'm lying if you look at me. Yeah, he runs. Okay, I do run. I try to run, right? And that's what's good. The watch will actually prove it. And right now, that's collecting information. What's going to happen is that machine learning will run on your phone. We're seeing that already. Might even run here. Or maybe this sends data. This is the sensor sending data to the phone. And looking at all your factors, it's going to be able to do predictions. Is this guy at risk of a heart attack? His heart rate's very high. It's consistently high. His step rate is very low. And it'll give you a warning. Listen, go to the doctor. And it's doing that in real time. And it will, at certain points, contact your medical aid scheme, give them the information. That'll go to the cloud from the edge. This is the edge. This is the edge. That's the cloud. And a proper machine learning model will run, but more accurate. That's what's going to happen. That's just one example of what's going to happen. Okay? My point is, it doesn't have to be complex and difficult. Some of the tools that you would use are tools that you're already familiar with, right? So you can talk to me a bit later on these. It's basically about collection of data, having the right sensors in place. For personal AI, AI at the edge, sensor technology is going to improve. There's a jacket that Ford released, not that you can buy it, but for cyclists. And it basically, if there's a van or a truck next to you, it lights up a little inbuilt LED on the sleeve. So when you're not always turning and looking, that's a safety thing, and that's smart clothing. So you're going to see smart clothing, right? So before I go into the video, our goal is to make it easy. We've got visual tools that help you drag and drop pre-built models. Okay, really shouldn't have an architecture diagram on a keynote, right? So visually, drag and drop, collect the data, apply a machine learning model, and we're trying to make it as easy as possible. So let me know. I've got three and a half minutes left. One of the things that we're doing now, Azure is the cloud offering, which will be in South Africa very soon. We're looking at the edge as well. We're not just focused on the cloud. So one of the things that we've come up with, and guys, ready for the video, is something called Azure Sphere. It's a set of standards for really smart devices at the edge. But what we've done is Microsoft, we focused on security. If you don't get security right at the edge, all these devices connected, you're going to have a real problem. So a framework to define a set of standards with security. Let's just have a look at this.
We're creating an entirely new class of microcontroller. They bring the same processor core that we've seen in smartphones and bring it down into a single chip package for the very first time.
We feel very strongly that we have now provided the foundation of cloud connectivity and security using Azure Sphere. And with that, we believe now, together, we have a springboard for the future.
Azure Sphere builds on decades of Microsoft's experience in security, in productivity, and cloud-enabled capabilities.
Of course, price is at the core of the microcontroller. These are single chip computers. Azure Sphere has to reach this very, very low price point.
If you are an original device manufacturer and you're already investing in the microcontroller in your device architecture, then with very little additional cost and with low complexity, you can adopt Azure Sphere technology.
Anyone who's building a device should have a no-compromise view on security. The goal for our product is to make this a reality for everybody.
Security is foundational. Azure Sphere security starts in the silicon and continues through the operating system and the cloud services. Experience has taught us that every component matters because your security is only as strong as your weakest link. Connectivity to the cloud creates for the very first time a connection between the device manufacturer and the device, and more importantly, a direct connection to your customers through that device.
It's getting harder and harder to find the software developers that can develop productively for legacy microcontroller platforms. One of the most fundamental behind-the-scenes benefits of Azure Sphere is that it brings the whole Visual Studio ecosystem into the microcontroller space.
What excites me most about this project is the scale. It is billions of new devices every year. And what we have is the capability of bringing and connecting all of these devices to the cloud, enabling new rich experiences that are going to affect every person and every organization on the planet.
With Azure Sphere, we fully expect to be surprised by the innovative ideas that you invent for the world and for your customers. I can hardly wait.
I hope you enjoyed that. Did I put you off to sleep? I think she knows this stuff already. I don't think I was that bad, right? And from here, guys, it's just going to get better. We're going to get mixed reality coming, HoloLens. We're going to get quantum computing coming along. Basically, there's so many things to talk about. If you're interested, if you've got questions, grab me on LinkedIn. I normally just accept invites, and I like chatting with people. I hope you enjoyed that. Have fun.